Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, everyone. This is Chrism, and I'd like to welcome you to a conversation about your Kundalini awakening experience. In this conversation, I'd like to discuss with you the effects of various light-bearing plants or plants that are of a psychotropic or psychedelic nature and their relationship to the Kundalini. It's often called the short path. However, in the beginning, I would like to say thank you to Amelia Santara and her family for sponsoring this program and co-hosting the program. So a big shout of gratitude to Amelia Santara and her family in the Kingdom of Kerry in the country of Ireland. So thank you, Amelia. And Amelia, if you have any announcements you would like to make.
Hello, everybody. Hi, Chrism. Yes, well, I suppose the first thing I'd like to do is to invite every listener to come to Dublin on Friday, the 18th of October, to meet with Chrism and with other Kundalini people who will be coming to a seminar that we're organising there. But seriously, if you do live in Europe or in the United Kingdom, it's a very short journey to come to Dublin. I think it's from London, it's less than an hour and a half. So if Kundalini is calling you to maybe attend this seminar, I would suggest paying attention to it and maybe coming, because this is a rare enough opportunity to meet with a teacher who is Kundalini awakened. And those of you who listen in on a regular basis here to the show, and those of you who are part of the community on Yahoo or the Kundalini Awakening groups on Facebook know very well what a special teacher Chrism is. And, you know, meeting with him will be really helpful for you and for your Kundalini Awakening process. Also, indeed, meeting with other Kundalini people is a very, very special thing. It's very rare to know other Kundalini people, so again, this is a great opportunity. So I'll give you the information about it. It's happening on the 18th, 19th and 20th of October. We gather together on the Friday, which is the 18th at 7 o'clock, and we are with each other right through until Sunday at 4 o'clock. It's going to be held in the Boyne Valley in an area called Newgrange, and this is only a half an hour from Dublin Airport. And as part of your coming, transport is going to be arranged if you fly in from Dublin Airport. So no worries there. You'll be picked up and brought to the place where the venue where the seminar is happening. So I'll give you the email address. If you've got any inquiries at all, please don't hesitate to contact me. The email address is kundalinimatters@gmail.com. kundalinimatters@gmail.com. And I have a phone number as well. If you're phoning from outside Ireland, it is 00353-86-029-7676. So you can give me a call by phone or send me an email, and I'd be delighted to speak with you about any aspect at all. And I would encourage all of you to really consider coming. It'll be a wonderful weekend. And I'd also, at this stage, like to give you the place you can go to on the internet if you would like to make a donation to support Chrism in the work that he does. The address is www.ascension-kundalini.blogspot.com. And as I always say, please know there's no requirement to donate and there's no pressure for you to do so. You know, Chrism is in a position where money for essentials and things is scarce, and there's not that much left over, and he fully understands what that is like. So you must always look after your own needs first, and if you're in a position then to donate, that is very much gratefully received with love and thanksgiving, and it is indeed a wonderful thing to do if you so can. Again, I'd like to just give you that address. It's www.ascension-kundalini.blogspot.com. So that's it, Chrism. And maybe I could just give out the address for the seminar again and my phone number at the end of the show.
Okay. All right. Thank you,
thanks,
Amelia.
Thank
you for those announcements. I see we have Brandon in the chat room. So hello, Brandon, and a couple of guests there. So I'd like to say hello to the people who are listening live. I would like to say hello to the people listening in the archives in the future. And I hope you also enjoy this presentation. So today we're talking about psychedelics. This would include, mostly for me, it includes plants that are psychedelic in their effect upon the human being. If any of you, Brandon, if you could let me know if you're hearing this okay. So if you just, you know, you can, I see you just said, hello, Chrism. So if you can let me know if this is coming through okay for you, okay? I appreciate that. Thank you. Let's see. So I'm going to wait until I get clearance here. I can hear you fine, Chrism. Ah, maybe slightly muffled. Thank you. Thank you, Brandon. I can hold that mic a little further away then. Okay. Light-bearing plants are any kind of a plant, seed, fungus, that gives a person hallucinatory experiences, experiences that would more properly be associated with psychic phenomena or spiritual phenomena. Okay. And a quick hello to Fashji, one of my private students. Hello, Fashji. I have taken ayahuasca and I've taken various components of what is considered to be the short path with regards to light-bearing plants. The one that I find to be the most conducive to Kundalini would be ayahuasca. The one that I would find to be most detrimental to Kundalini would be psilocybin or magic mushrooms. Not through any, you know, problem with the plant itself or the fungus itself. It's just when a person is searching for Kundalini and then takes magic mushrooms or psilocybin in conjunction with that search, it can damage some of the upper chakras for that person and blow huge gaping holes into their energetic anatomy, and it really unleashes a level of experience that is not the easiest for people to work through. With the psilocybin, I would be very, very, very careful, as well as any of the other plant helpers. These are extreme nature spirits, and they have an effect on a person that you know, that can be really, really good sometimes, or really, really detrimental at other times. And so, I would like you to keep that in mind and allow yourself caution when you ingest any kind of a psychotropic or psychedelic light-bearing plant. So the first one I would like to really talk about is ayahuasca. I mentioned this in the last program we had last week, and ayahuasca is part of the Liliana vine, a plant species that grows in South America and some of the other tropical countries. Ayahuasca, in the Amazon basin, there's approximately 17 species of ayahuasca. You have black ayahuasca, white ayahuasca, yellow ayahuasca, red ayahuasca. The black ayahuasca is typically a larger diameter in the vine that is used. It's an older vine. Some of the, like the yellow ayahuasca, is typically a younger vine, and so the diameter on those on the yellow ayahuasca is much thinner than, say, on the black ayahuasca. They're for the people that partake of these on a fairly regular basis, such as the shamans in the area, they, because of their use and their experience with it, they can differentiate the qualities of black ayahuasca versus the qualities of any of the other varieties of ayahuasca. Now, the component of ayahuasca, the tea, which is really what we're talking about here, the component of ayahuasca is the liliana vine itself, the ayahuasca itself, which is also referred to in some areas as la purga, which means the purge, or the vine of life, or the vine of death, because it can illuminate you to such a degree that you experience a death of your old life and an invitation into a new understanding of life. And so sometimes you'll see that I'm pausing here because I'm trying to work with the technology. Okay. Here in the studio, I have two computers that I have to monitor while I'm surrendering to my Kundalini and it's speaking. So it can get a little disjointed at times. I apologize. Okay. So one half of ayahuasca is the liliana vine. Okay. And as I mentioned before, there are 17 different species of that. In just say the Amazon basin, which would include Brazil, Colombia, parts of Venezuela, Honduras, Peru, Bolivia, okay, all the way down to borders with Montevideo and Argentina, and you know, anywhere where the weather is conducive for this liliana vine to grow. The ayahuasca is mixed with a DMT-containing plant, which is typically, you know, there are many different mixture plants that the shamans in the Amazon basin will use. But one of the main ones is called chacruna. And I used to know the Latin name for that, but I don't at the moment. It's called chacruna, C-H-A-C-R-U-N-A, chacruna. And chacruna has dimethyltryptamine within its properties, and the ayahuasca has the MAO inhibitor, which allows passage from the digestive tract and into the, you know, through the blood-brain barrier. So these two plants work synergistically to bring to a person an experience of a psychedelic nature for the person, experimenting with ayahuasca. Ayahuasca is known to be a teacher, a very, very powerful plant teacher. And to understand the teachings of ayahuasca is to really begin to take a trip into your own karma, into your own current life disposition and assumptions and fears and, you know, the issues that we need to work through, you know, as we continue our path of refinement into the Kundalini. As the ayahuasca experience begins to unfold for the person, many different options of expression are available within the synergistic experience with the ayahuasca and the human. The ayahuasca will pretty much kind of take control of many portions of the human consciousness in order to communicate what it wants to communicate to a person. There is definitely a spiritual expression that comes from the ayahuasca. Definitely a spiritual expression. And many times people will see some of the Kundalini phenomena exposing itself to them, even though most of those people won't realize it's Kundalini phenomena because they think they're just taking a drug and you know, A plus B equals C. You know, take the drug, wait a few minutes, and you know, you start feeling the drug. They won't recognize it as Kundalini symptomology. And so, you know, they'll just go ahead and have the ride, have the fun. A lot of these people are taking ayahuasca as a way to clarify for themselves spiritual undertaking, spiritual convergence with perhaps their higher parts. Some of the people are going in for shamanic studies. Some of the people are there to be healed, healed of addiction, healed of the many different qualities of addiction that perpetuate despondency in the United States, whether it's an eating addiction or a lack of eating addiction or a drinking alcohol addiction or taking hard drugs such as cocaine or crack or any of the really, you know, methamphetamine-based recreational substances. The ayahuasca has the ability to literally vanquish those addictions. And it doesn't matter what addiction it is. It goes to the area of addiction in your brain. And from there, it begins to work on whatever addiction a person might have, whether it's, you know, a sex addiction or an addiction to cigarettes. You know, they're treated, you know, in the same way by the ayahuasca, which is as a way of removing them from an expressive experience within the human system. I find ayahuasca within that context to be a very, very, very helpful plant helper, a very, very effective light-bearing plant, and definitely one to consider if you're having, you know, difficulties in overcoming specific areas of addiction. There is actually a hospital down there in Peru, in the northern section of Peru, Terrapoto, that's T-E-R-R-A space P-O-T-O. In Terrapoto, Peru, there's literally a hospital, a multi-story hospital that is run by people that are using ayahuasca as a medical intervention into healing and into the balancing of a person from an addiction. So, you know, this is starting to catch on. Although, you know, there's a lot of money tied up in addiction. And so, of course, in the United States, what do? Well, we make ayahuasca a Class D scheduled drug, make it illegal to have or to use as a plant medicine in the United States. And so people do it illegally here in the States, or they go to a country that supports its use, such as, you know, some of the indigenous areas in the Amazon basin. Now, where I went to experience ayahuasca was in Peru. I took a couple of students, and we went to a place in Peru called Pucallpa. That would be P-U-C-A-L-P-A, Pucallpa, Peru. And that is right on the shore of the Ucuyali River, one of the major tributaries to the Amazon, which, boy, when you see that river, it's absolutely huge, huge. And it has a ripping flow to it. It flows fast, very fast. The only way you can really navigate it is by boat. And most of the navigation is done by banana boats. So you get on your banana boat, or you make a deal with that boat driver, and, you know, they'll agree to drop you off down the river a few ways. So the various villages that exist along the river. And the village that I went to is called New Britannia, which is kind of an odd name for an Indian village along the Ucayali, the New Britannia. But okay, whatever. You know, I went there, and there's a guy there that they call the Dolphin Shaman. And he's called the Dolphin Shaman because he does a lot of work with the river dolphins, the two species of river dolphins in the area, the Boto, or the pink river dolphin, which grows about 14 feet and is supposed to be as smart as a human being. And then the other dolphin, which is a silver or a gray dolphin, another river dolphin. And they're also quite intelligent, very, very, very intelligent. And they live and flourish in the area of Pucallpa and other stretches of the river that I visited. Okay, so the dolphin shaman, he'll do an ayahuasca ceremony based upon the communication with dolphins. Now you may hear a bird or a dog behind me. I have a cockatoo that's kind of sitting right on top of me, and he might say hello. So just realize that. I am not broadcasting from the Amazon, just so you know. Okay, I am here in Santa Rosa. Now, so I won't go into the ayahuasca ceremony because a lot of it's sacred work and it has to be sung. So the shaman is singing during the entire ceremony, and you typically will get the tea in two separate instances during the ceremony. And it's always an option. You can take a small ounce of the tea, and then if you want, you know, if you feel like you need more of an experience, well, then once again, you can take the other ounce, and that is about all you're going to get. Okay, and then you don't fall asleep, and you really can't, because the ayahuasca will kind of take hold of you, and you may feel the need to vomit or to purge yourself. And this is normal. This is why ayahuasca is called la purga, the purge in English. And basically what is occurring is the toxicities of toxic emotions, toxic thoughts, even toxic material that's actually in your system needs to come up and out. And as it comes up and out, your system is purified. And as the purification takes place, well, the light-bearing plant is infusing more and more and more light into a person's energetic anatomy. And this begins to become the dominant source of sensory reception within the person. And you know, depending on how long you have to purge will determine how long it is before you begin to get very, very strong, enjoyable aspects from the experience. I have to say, the big caveat here is everybody is different. Everybody is different. And so, you know, I'm certainly not going to say that it's this way for everybody. Just like Kundalini, people come to this with different karma. Well, with the ayahuasca, people come to this with their own individual, unique issues and attributes that will get fed into the ayahuasca, and the ayahuasca will determine a level of teaching that person will experience. Now, there's an anthropologist out there. I think his name is Jeremy Narby, or Narby, and I'm not quite sure on his first name, but I am sure on his last name. And he went down to the Amazon and he tried, you know, the ayahuasca, and he had some very interesting experiences with it that are somewhat common. I mean, some of his experiences, seeing the giant bejeweled anacondas, the talking serpents, and having the serpents come up to you and say something like, "You don't know as much as you think you know. Here, why don't you consider being more forgiving?" Or, "Why don't you consider trusting your own spiritual evolution in a better way, or why don't you do this, or why don't you get rid of that in your life? I mean, they really begin to dissect your life in a way that begins to show the consciousness of the person a way into greater appreciation of the life that they currently live. So yeah, it's a very powerful experience. And I do, for Kundalini, this can activate your Kundalini. If you have a signature in your energetic anatomy that allows for you to be activated through a light-bearing plant, well, the ayahuasca can do that. There's various writers, from Greg Braden to other writers in the New Age written material, who write about the ayahuasca and the different effects that the person can have with the ayahuasca. When I took the ayahuasca, I had a bowl there to, you know, in case I had to purge, and I felt the need to purge, and I tried to push myself to purge, but there was nothing for me to purge. I was all dressed up with a party bowl and the whole bit, and nothing to put in it. But I was, on the other hand, I was quite happy not to have to purge. And immediately I am like in a high orbit of the earth, and I see I see a giant serpent circling the earth, you know, and holding it in its it's like the earth is an egg, and the snake is wrapped around the earth, holding it together, holding it in place for people to have the level of spiritual evolution that they're having on this planet as we speak. Before I get too far gone into this, I'd like to put out the call-in number. If you have an experience with ayahuasca or another light-bearing plant, and you're interested in Kundalini, call in at 347-934-0026. That's a United States area code 347-934-0026, and Amelia Santara, she'll take your call, and we'll get to your question as quickly as we can. Now, as the person goes into the ayahuasca experience, before they even got to the special place where they do the ayahuasca experience and they sing it and everybody makes their intentions known and all of this, there are 2 days of fasting that I will recommend before you go into an ayahuasca experience. Eat no animal fats. No animal proteins or animal fats. Don't eat mangoes. Don't drink any alcohol. Don't, if you're a smoker, try to back off of smoking the cigarettes. I noticed a lot of people doing the ayahuasca in Peru, and they're also mixing in marijuana and various other things. And this places it more into the context of a recreational experience. And I would never, ever, ever, ever take ayahuasca as a recreational experience. It's got to be there as an educational tool. It is not there to use and abuse as so many of us will do with regards to the short path. You know, we don't want to have to put a lot of work into the short path. Now, some of you have also awakened with the use of LSD, there are fewer people that have had a positive experience within an awakening context with the LSD than there are those who've had a positive experience with it. But for those who've had the positive experience with it, you're well on your way, and you understand a lot of what I'm talking about with regards to ayahuasca and some of the other light-bearing plants we'll be discussing today. You know what it's like to be activated through that venue. And if you're fortunate enough to find a path of spiritual exploration based upon your experiences with ayahuasca or with LSD or any of the light-bearing plants, well, then you're indeed blessed, and I really support you as you begin and continue your spiritual journey that the light-bearing plant or substance may have helped you upon, like LSD. Even though LSD is based on ergot or a grain mold, most of the LSD, I think, is fabricated, cooked by somebody. And I can't promote any of these uses legally. Can't go on the air and say, oh, use this or oh, use that. But I can tell you about what happens when a person does go into a country that recognizes the legal use of any of these light-bearing plants and what happens with them. As the ayahuasca experience takes hold of the person, on the positive side of things, less purging, great levels of joy can be experienced, great levels of laughter, of joy, completion, union, all of these, many of the, similar things that will happen with the Kundalini, except the ayahuasca experience will come and then it will go. And of course it will stay, the memory of it and the processing of it will stay for a while. But if you have a really, really strong experience with the ayahuasca, you're going to have the tendency to want to do it again and again and again and again. And this can lead to a dependency of spiritual education based upon your use of this light-bearing plant. And I'm going to suggest that you do not do this, that you do not do this. You do not get addicted to the information or the euphoria that a person can experience with regards to using ayahuasca or any of the light-bearing plants. And there is an element of euphoria involved. And I think this is what attracts a lot of people when they're using any of the light-bearing plants, is they get that high, they get that really wonderful euphoric feeling, and this is what they want to continuously experience, because it's maybe it's a little bit better than their non light-bearing plant reality. So as a person takes the ayahuasca, the ayahuasca begins to control that person's experience. Visions are seen, noises are heard, animal noises. Sometimes a person will see a jaguar, or sometimes a person will see an anaconda, or any of the animal plants and the animal archetypes that work for the person that is experiencing this will be brought for that person. Now, you have to remember that I am looking at this from a Kundalini context. I'm not so much looking at this from the angle of a person just wanting to go down and try ayahuasca. Ayahuasca can activate the Kundalini. Ayahuasca can help a person who is already Kundalini active, and it can help them discover certain areas within their behaviors and expressions that can be adjusted that will allow a greater flow and a greater understanding of the Kundalini to be given into the person. Ayahuasca opens the doors to experiences that are not based purely in the physical. You'll hear the music that the shaman is singing. If you have a good shaman, which I do, he will sing, and he will apply certain individual movements for people. If one person is having a hard time with the purge, well then, a certain administration of attention will be given to that person. Another person is whooping and hollering and having a great time. Well, that person was just kind of like left alone and allowed to express the way that the ayahuasca wants to express through them. The ayahuasca takes hold of a person much in the same way that the Kundalini takes hold of a person. You get choices of how the expression is going to occur for you. You basically agree to take the tea, and once you take the tea, for the next 12 hours, you're pretty much under the control of the tea. This is crucial because typically you'll want to take ayahuasca three separate times. It's not a one-time thing. You don't get all this with just a one-time event. With typical Western-oriented societies, the people collect a lot of negativity in their expression, and a lot of negativity in what happens to them. And they come down to Peru, or they come into an ayahuasca ceremony, and they take the ayahuasca, and they have to spend some time purging through those things. Even if you take the fast and you do the fast and everything is going well, if you have a lot of life experience where not a lot of forgiveness has been shown, or it's been, you know, it hasn't been a focus of the individual, well, that individual will take some time to purge through the various challenges that are being brought up for them. And so a three-time scenario is really kind of the best. And if you can do it with the same shaman in the same place, that is an added benefit. Now, when I was in Peru, I participated with the dolphin shaman, and then in Pucallpa, another shaman there, his name is Ishmael. He's a very good shaman as well. And then there's an ancient site that is pre-Incan that's up near the shores of Lake Titicaca. Some people call it a stargate. Some people call it the reclining woman. But it's a fairly large Egyptian-style wall with columns carved into the rock. It's very different from any of the Incan or some of the things that you'll see in Cusco. This place is just amazing. Anyway, on the other side of this artifact, or this archaeological gorgeous monument, is a cave in the rock. And then we spent the night and did an ayahuasca ceremony on the other side of that artifact. Very, very interesting experiences that I'll go into at another time. Once again, I want to put the phone numbers out. The phone number for guest call-in is United States area code 347-934-0026, 347-934-0026. You begin a journey of blending into the natural energetic systems. And natural energetic systems are similar and yet powerfully different than your normal relationship that you might have with the wilderness in general. Now, if you're Kundalini awakened and you're in the wilderness, well, you're kind of you're different in your energetic signature and how you're received by nature in its wild state. And doesn't mean that you won't be killed by the anaconda or by the jaguar. But it does mean that you're given a different level of respect and communication. But if you do something that makes you pray, well, then pray you shall be. With regards to the jungle. Now, you do it three times. You do the first time to get most of the purging out. You do it the second time to clean up any purges. You do it the third time to really open yourself to what the ayahuasca has to offer. Okay. Now, as I mentioned before, you can make ayahuasca with the Liliana vine, which is the vine of life, or the ayahuasca, La Purga. mixing it with chacruna. So you have the MAO inhibitor and you have the chacruna, which contains the DMT, dimethyltryptamine. And then, but you can also, you know, some of the shamans also put in Syrian rue. They mix in different light-bearing plants that have that give the ayahuasca a different teaching, so to speak. I mean, it's really interesting how smart the light-bearing plants really are and how they do work well with the kundalini in a person. Not when it becomes an addiction, however. If you get so addicted to ayahuasca that you have to keep using it in order to have any kind of a spiritual experience, well, you've just become addicted to something, and this begins to limit what you can appreciate with regards to having the freedom to experience your kundalini as the kundalini wants you to experience it. Excuse me. So once again, with the ayahuasca, we don't do it recreationally. And yes, I know it fights addiction and other things, but it doesn't necessarily fight addiction with itself. Okay. On my visit down there and, you know, seeing the people and listening to the attitudes of Norte Americanos as well as Europeans about ayahuasca and how important it is to get high and, you know, and to smoke the pot, you know, and all this stuff. It's just like, no. Not a kundalini person. And I'm not making a judgment of pot or any of that. I'm not making, and I'll be talking about that later on in the show today. Because pot is also a light-bearing plant. Yes, Amelia. Hello.
Oh, this is Drakina. Hi, Master Chrism. How are you?
Okay. Hi, Drakina. Good. Thank you for asking. How are you?
I'm doing great. So I had a question regarding ayahuasca. I know you and I had touched on it briefly in a private message, but I just figured I would ask because now there's that chance to expound on it. So what would you say would be a good time for somebody who has been awakened in the kundalini to approach ayahuasca as a plant teacher? I know you mentioned addiction, but I guess how would one know that it's a good thing or maybe not a positive thing?
Well, okay, so depending on how you're relating currently with your experience, just a second here. I guess Centauri is on. Okay, good. Okay, so typically you would go into this before you have a kundalini awakening, and this would help you into the awakening. And frankly, I'll be honest with you, it's custom when it comes to the individual person. So Drakina would require an individual assessment that the ayahuasca and her kundalini would make as she is taking the ayahuasca. So an individual assessment of her needs and what education she needs to experience with regards to that would be instantly given. It does not take a lot of time. I would think nanoseconds, okay, a billionth of a second, okay? It's very, very fast. It does not adhere to any of the timelines that we require in order to make an advanced diagnosis of a person, you know, with whatever. So it can be positive for the person coming into the kundalini. For the person that already has the kundalini, such as yourself, Drakina, your current level right now is positive for ayahuasca teachings. Where you are right now can help you to not give your energy or your attentions to areas of life that are not beneficial to you or your kundalini awakening experience. So the ayahuasca would basically take you aside, and we'll just say, you know, one of the bejeweled anacondas comes up to Drakina and says, you know, congratulations with the kundalini, but here's where you need to do some work.
know? Right.
You got to listen to the snake. The mouth won't move, but you'll hear the words in your head. So it's a telepathic commitment. So where you are right now, and I'm going to, with your permission, Drakina, I would like to mention about how long you've been activated. Okay, is that all right?
Sure.
Drakina has been activated for about 2 weeks now. Is that correct, or 3 weeks?
2 weeks, yeah, a little over, just about 2 weeks.
Yeah, a little over 2 weeks. You know, she had, you know, the big experience on one of those Mondays 2 weeks ago, and she's been basically blooming inside the Kundalini ever since then. And I think she's doing quite well. But, you know, the ayahuasca may say, well, Chrism, you know, you're not looking deep enough into her scenario. Here, let's look at this karma here. Let's look at what she's done in this life right now. And let's look at, you know, the kind of relationship she's in. And let's look what at the relationship with her family. And has she finished the karma with her family? Does she finish karma that she needs in order to be able to claim a greater expression of Kundalini? And the ayahuasca will just get right into your stuff and begin to present to you options that allow you to flow in a better way with the Kundalini expression you have right now. I say for you right now, because Drakina, you're quite new to this. You're the equivalent of an infant, newborn infant. But I mean, you know, a newborn infant that's come into this world to have Kundalini. So, you know, on the one hand, you know, there's no accident that you're having it the way you're having it right now. And on the other hand, you're at an early enough stage of it that if you wanted to do an ayahuasca ceremony, that it would be quite beneficial for you. Did I lose her? I don't see her anywhere. Amelia, Tantara, hello. I guess, let's see. Hello.
Hi.
Is this Drakina?
Hi. Yeah, sorry. That's that whole electrical issue I've been having.
Oh, yeah. The Kundalini and the electrics. Yes, I can. Well, congratulations for even having that. So yeah, I would think that a high ayahuasca journey done in Peru under the auspices of not the dolphin shaman so much, but I think Ishmael would probably be the better shaman for you. And you and your husband could go down there and have a great time, number one, visiting the Amazon. It's an amazing place, number one. And number two, have a great education vis-a-vis the ayahuasca. It will not hurt your Kundalini.
I actually had a quick question to piggyback off of that. So I think I mentioned in passing that my husband had recently done DMT. It was interesting because my awakening occurred, and we met this friend that basically he was awakened to Kundalini like a year ago, and he's all about plant teachers. But basically he, you know, administered it to my husband, walked him through it, and let him know, hey, it's going to be probably the most challenging experience of your life. Now, my husband hasn't been awakened to Kundalini, but he's very spiritual, and he's very open, and he had a very intense experience. So I guess my question would be, what's the main difference between DMT and ayahuasca, other than like the intensity and the time span? And I mean, is there a difference between one or the other as far as which one would be more positive at what time frame?
Well, there's a huge difference between the two. DMT, dimethyltryptamine, is a stripped-down, purified molecule that is produced by the pineal gland when we sleep, and in many other instances during, you know, our own body chemistry. And in accordance with typical scientific ignorance, we assume that, hey, dude, you know, if we like take more, well, then it's going to be better. You know, more is always better, right? So we find a way to artificially produce the molecule, and then we take the molecule, and you get about a 15-minute journey, and you'll go to a place that you have absolutely no reference for, on the one hand. And then on the other hand, you might go into a very beautiful trip with the DMT, but typically it's very short, and you won't understand what's occurring. Now, it doesn't mean that you won't have a fabulous thing, but typically, like, you know, you go to the place where there's 1,000 blue eyes staring at you from the walls and things like that. If you don't know what that is, then you're just like looking at a wall full of eyes, and the wall full of eyes are looking back at you, and you're looking back at them, and it's just kind of like, well, WTF?
You know, I was actually sort of, I don't know if I'd mentioned when I shared my awakening experience in the groups, how mine started off. So I've been doing a lot of, I want to call it energy work, for several years, different healing techniques and meditations and workshops and shadow work and astral traveling and stuff like that. And so I feel like I might have been on the precipice, and I've even had some dreams that, looking back now after listening to your video about dreaming and how the Kundalini speaks, I feel like the Kundalini was reaching out to me before it even happened. But what really sort of triggered it for me was when I had did a TCB, which I don't even know why. I just felt prompted to do it. And I'm not really a kind of person that does, like, recreational drugs much. I mean, maybe in my past, but not these days.
This was PCP, and, you say?
Oh, no. TCB, which is, I guess, a cousin of Molly and mescaline.
Oh, okay, okay. So you're going into the tech? Yeah,
and so it was very intense for me. And the part that I didn't mention is, I know I mentioned the part where I saw Shiva and Shakti energy sort of in this collective form, and then I saw my own energy as this collective dragon. And it really scared the crap out of me initially, but then I felt like it was, I didn't have to be afraid. So I started to lift off, and I remember saying to my husband and our new friend, I said, you know, I'm going to go now. See you guys later. And I started to lift off on this white geometric shape, and everything turned into this swirling tunnel, and then I panicked, and I opened my eyes. And I felt like the experience kind of pursued me, because as I was walking around in the room, there was like this steam coming from the floor, and this dragon energy was almost like it was reaching in through the walls and stuff, and I just really felt like I kind of shortchanged myself. I didn't finish.
Well,
and
well,
I think that's maybe my motivation for wanting to do that.
I think that the very fact that you had Kundalini phenomena occur so early in the journey, the Shakti, the Shiva, this was all about Kundalini. This was nothing about the
drug. Absolutely.
So really, you didn't shortchange yourself at all. I mean, the one thing that needed to be shown to you was shown to you right at the beginning of the journey. That was the only thing that mattered in that journey. Okay,
that. Because I've been worried about that.
Right.
Well,
Now, that Shakti and Shiva doesn't mean that you all of a sudden become a Hindu. You know, it doesn't mean that you're all of a sudden, you know, getting into any of the Indus Peninsula shamanic or religious, beautiful religions, by the way, beautiful spiritual belief systems in the Indus Peninsula. Everything from shamanism to Hinduism to all the different schools of thought in India, which are far too many for me to mention. But I honor those that are positive. The situation with Yudhrakina was that your Kundalini was just basically waiting there to show you that this is your path. Kundalini is your path. And so everything that occurred to you under the auspices of that last journey that you're describing, because the first thing that was shown to you was of a Kundalini nature, you know, Shakti and Shiva. So everything comes under that heading that follows that. You see, one of the things
it was actually really intense, because as before I even saw, and I want to say her because that, like, the Shakti was the most prevalent energy for me, but before I even saw her, like, I took a deep breath and, you know, this fire just rose right up my spine, and I started doing kriyas on my right hand and then my left. I didn't know what it was, so of course I was like, what is going on? And I was guided, as I was guided to move, I was guided to breathe in certain moments. And all of a sudden I saw these flower petals just burst out of the top of my head. And my friend that was there goes, wow, it looks like you're having a Kundalini awakening. And he goes, that's strange, because the type of drug you did isn't even that much of a hallucination. I was just like, well, I don't think it was.
But, you know, let's look at your history again. I mean, you know, doing energetic work for a couple of years, and I believe it's of a healing venue. So you're giving service of an energetic quality for a certain amount of time, correct?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And so you were also compelled to do that. You were also compelled to begin to explore yourself from an energetic quality. And then as you pursued your experience, your spiritual development, and you took this mescaline-based situation, well, the Kundalini co-opted that experience for you. It just co-opted it, showing itself to you. It's Shakti and Shiva, and allowing that to be a chapter heading for you. And then everything else that followed in the experience would have ramification from Kundalini to you.
Right. Right. And okay, and it's, it makes perfect sense what you're saying, because all the animals that I've seen, like in my dreaming state and my waking state, they all are red. Or somehow I can see the Shakti energy in them somehow.
Yeah,
and,
yeah, exactly.
And it's interesting, you know.
Well, now you're basically a three-week-old infant with this. And so some of this that you're experiencing right now is of a very, very, very newborn type of application from the Kundalini to you. So, yes, at this point, you'll see the red fox. You'll see the red pomegranate. You'll see the red hawk or the red bird or the red serpent. Matter of fact, in the Amazon basin, their name for Kundalini is the red serpent energy. Okay?
Oh, wow.
So this is transcultural. This is definitely multicultural. The Kundalini is. Kundalini is multicultural. And so, looks like I'm getting some interference here. Let's see. Okay. So as your Kundalini awakening commences, you'll find less and less of a dream expression of showing you the red. Once the Kundalini is fairly confident about your understanding of what is occurring, you know, you'll start moving into areas that are more
challenging.
I try to be careful about how often I put challenging in there. It can be challenging for sure, but more areas of a more refining type basis. So yeah, you know, if you have a grudge or some level of forgiveness that needs to be given that hasn't been given, well then you're going to be stimulated into giving that forgiveness. Basically, Kundalini begins to determine your behavioral response to given stimuli. Okay. You'll be given a very irritating boss or a stranger, or you're put in a situation where you have to deal with irritating people in order to help you with your forgiveness, help you with your tolerance, help you with your patience, help you with your compassion, help you, you know, with your ability to see through another person's problem and not let those problems become your problems, that type of a
right.
Scenario.
Not take it personal.
Right, not take that energy into yourself. And so it's
interesting,
you know,
you're saying this, because I've had, well, besides the fact that the Kundalini for me so far has been more active at night, and I don't know if it's because I can't resist, at least not as much, but I'll have visions when I wake up to use the restroom, or like the other night I saw my husband floating on the ceiling, which was interesting, and all these things. Whereas before Kundalini, I would see impressions, but it was more like an impression. It's like I'm seeing it with my physical eyes, which is completely new for me. And
that's a real thing. But listen to yourself. Listen to yourself describe this. Listen to yourself and listen to the lack of fear that is in your voice. This isn't something that's terrified you to the point where you feel like you need to self-commit into a psych ward, right?
No, because I've been seeing crazy stuff my whole life, so this is just kind of a more, it's like I'm seeing it in my five senses versus, even though it's not, I'm obviously seeing it in my six senses, but it's as though I'm experiencing it in everyday life, so it's kind of like the next stage for me, and I'm not scared,
so.
I just want to learn, and I want to grow, and I want to eventually be able to help other people do the same who are in my situation now, and
you're doing that right now by just calling in. Because these programs I'm doing, they have a much larger audience in the archives than they do with the blessed people who are listening live. And I want to thank the live listeners and the archive listeners for their attention that they give to this channel. So with you, I would suggest, Rakina, that you listen to the previous shows in the archives. Okay, listen to them, and if you feel like your Kundalini is in agreement with what I'm telling you, which is coming straight to my Kundalini, then I will suggest that you follow the intuition that your Kundalini gives you. Okay, do be very careful about surfing the internet and pulling information from here and pulling information from there. Look to where your Kundalini has guided you to receive information, and then stick to that source until the Kundalini moves you.
Oh, that's really good advice, because I'm always everywhere. So this is actually, I think, one of the lessons I'm learning right now is to hone in and really concentrate on the subtle guidance. That what you said just really resonates with me, and I'm already dealing with a lot of the emotional stuff, like crying fits and then feeling happy afterward, and I know that it's coming from like my sacral area, like there's a lot of past trauma stuff that's being healed. And it's crazy because for all these years, right, I was trying all these different things and all these different techniques, and the Kundalini is just going in there and just flushing everything out. It's just absolutely, it's amazing, and it's just, it blows my mind. It's all these years, and it's like I knew nothing. I still don't know anything.
Well,
it's just crazy.
You know, in a very real way, you have earned this experience. This experience doesn't just happen accidentally. Kundalini is not an accidental process. Even when it awakens in what would be considered an accidental context, like in a car accident or a skiing accident, or you know, some sort of a sports related accident, or accidental trauma to the tailbone, etc. Your Kundalini is not accidental to you. You were meant to have this, and the way that you're handling it is really a very clear indication that you're stepping on board a boat that you had already bought a ticket to board.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
It really does.
So I would like to congratulate you. I'd like to congratulate you with it. And I would like you to consider that last little bit of advice seriously. I get a lot of people that are butterflies. They take a little here, they take a little there, they take a little here, they take a little there. And I'm not against that. I'm just saying that if your Kundalini has guided you to a certain teacher or group of information, or, you know, a place of information, then you need to listen to that Kundalini guidance. It's not there to just you know, sip and go. It's there for you to really, really delve into. So, you know, this isn't just for you, Drakina. This is for everybody. take an inventory of where your Kundalini is taking you. Look at what it is you do just because you feel pulled to, or your interest level is perked up by this certain thing, and all of a sudden you start reading the information or you hear it, and that information starts to make a whole lot of sense to you. Stick with that information.
It's interesting you're saying that. It's kind of confirming for me. I've been really, I don't want to say obsessed, but I've been really interested in how the Kundalini communicates, especially in dreams, because I have dreams every night, and so I'm definitely going to keep a dream journal, and I used to, and then I kind of got away from it, so I know I really need to do that. That's kind of where my focus is right now, that and learning how to surrender. So those are kind of my two primary, those are the two areas I'm drawn to, and I've been watching, like, your videos about it trying to kind of learn and absorb from people as well. So I thank you for that. I really appreciate that.
Oh, you're very welcome. You're very welcome. And speaking of thank yous, I'd like to say thank you to Ravenese and Kundalini Fire and Celestial Rubies, Brandon, Fasci, and then the guests, 2305, 2392, 2717, 2727, 2747, 2823, and 18380. Thank you all for listening live to this Kundalini Awakening discussion. Jerkina, so yeah, you know that right now you want to know about the language. There's a special language that Kundalini uses to communicate with her children. The very special language that you're just starting to learn. So when you start seeing red in your dreams, that's always of a Shakti nature, unless, you know, you're at a stage where you're being manipulated by other consciousness. Typically, red will be the sacred feminine, and typically blue, a kind of a dark cobalt blue, will be the sacred male. Okay? Looks like, Centaur, are you online here? Looks like you're listening here.
Yes, I am, cousin.
You just, okay, all right, so... Kundalini will speak to you through the ayahuasca as a top of the food chain predator, like a wasp or a serpent or a tiger or an eagle or a condor or a lion or a bear or a killer whale or a, you know, top of the food chain within their phylum, within the species phylum that they're following. So, for instance, the wasp or the hornet is a top of the food chain predator within the vespid community. The vespids are the name of the wasp family, so to speak. And you have the paper wasp, and you have the black wasp, and the hornets, and all that. These are all Kundalini creatures, and if you communicate them within a Kundalini context, communicate with them, they will not harm you. They will land on you, and they will not harm you. Okay, so every, you know, a person in Drakina's special situation, she can begin to really benefit from speaking and learning the Kundalini language now, so soon in her process. That will keep her from becoming disjointed and confused as you know, some of the refinement process continues. You know, as she mentioned, it may be more challenging later on, and it will be. I mean, I'm sure. It's normal, you know, after 3 weeks, you know, you're fairly new into this, and the very fact that you kind of had it started through a mescaline, I think is interesting. I think that has a very profound level of meaning for you. As a matter of fact, I would, if I were you, Drakina, I would start taking care of a cactus that mescaline is derivative of, or at least in honor of the source genetics for the medicine that you took.
I actually really love cacti, so
there you
but
go.
I think
there
I'll
go.
Probably do that.
There you
I had one more quick question actually. So and basically when so at night a lot of times you know I'll be woken up in these strange positions, and at one point, and I don't know if it was my physical body resisting to what was happening, but at one point it almost felt like my jaw was going to be dislocated. It wasn't, obviously. And then I'll have like these feelings like somebody's doing surgery on my head, and it kind of feels like a tickling, so I'm learning to just surrender to that and not, you know, not be afraid. So,
well,
yeah, there's
good.
All these little sensations.
You might get the little welding that'll go in inside your inner ear, near your tympanic membrane. You may begin to have what's the word I'm looking for? You'll have like air imbalances inside the head. So one side of your head will feel like it's stuffed up. The other side of the head will feel clear, and then it'll migrate throughout the brain area. I mean, you know,
I've had that already. It almost feels like allergies.
Right, exactly. and you can, you know, you'll also have the cranial migrations, the cranial plate migrations, and, you know, all these different phenomena are kind of like waiting for you to occur, and they will occur for you if your karma suggests that they need to. If your karma
right.
doesn't suggest that you need to have it, then you won't have it. It's not part of the process for you.
So should I not be taking allergy meds? Because I did have a feeling it happened like literally almost right after my awakening, and I didn't really connect the dots until just now.
Your drainage, may in fact be part of a refining program for you, letting go of the mucus that may be lodged in your sinus, your sinus tract areas. Let that drain naturally. Let it go. In other words, don't use an antihistamine to dry it up, okay?
Okay.
Let it go.
Yeah, I was just feeling that, and so thank you for that, because I just thought about that. I'm trying really hard not to interfere with any processes. I didn't even think about that.
It sounds like you seem to be coming along quite well with this, and as I suggested earlier, this is something that you are supposed to be having. So because you're supposed to be having it, as all people who have Kundalini are supposed to be having it, the greater your surrender into it is, the stronger your ability to walk with this path will be. You know, this path is a dual path. It's a path that you walk, but it's also a path that walks you. And so as it is walking you right now, because you're so young inside of it, later on, as you learn the language and you learn the lessons that the Kundalini wants to give to you, your greater expansion into the heavenly fields will occur. This is something that will last for the rest of your life, my dear, and as it should be.
Excellent. Thank you so much. I don't want to take up any more of your time. I really feel like I've received the wisdom that I need right now, and I really appreciate that. Some of the stuff I didn't even think of, and other things are confirmation, and I just thank you, as always, for your wisdom from the Kundalini.
Well, you're absolutely welcome, Jakina, and I want to congratulate you belatedly on this beautiful, wonderful process that you have been initiated into. Congratulations.
Thank you. I'm excited.
Okay.
Well, have a good evening.
Thank you, ma'am. You as well. You as well.
All right.
Okay. So, yeah. So, I didn't get to the mescaline, peyote, and some of the plant helpers are also very, very powerful. And they like, say, peyote also has a purging effect. I mean, if you eat the peyote buttons, you know, eat four or five buttons, you know, and you're going to have a vomiting time. You know, it doesn't dominate the entire experience, but it does have its say within the experience. And I'm going to just quickly shoot through some of the light-bearing plants that will have a direct effect with your kundalini. Now, some of you will be searching for soma. Soma is the legendary five constituent light-bearing plant. When mixed together, will push a person into an ascendancy expression. Fortunately for humanity, the recipe for the soma is not in wide distribution. When we're talking about the recipe for soma, some people feel that it's ayahuasca, Syrian rue, cannabis, the poppy plant, and one other constituent that I can't think of at the top of my head. And then you take these in various amounts at the same time, which I don't recommend. And you know, if it kills you, I guess you've ascended. If it doesn't kill you, then you may have wished that it had. Typically, it isn't a good idea to take so many all at the same time. I have an aunt actually, who was a child of the '60s, and one day she tried a lot of different things at the same time. And you know, she wound up in a psych ward for over a year, and came out of it still seeing hallucinations and the whole bit, and she's able to process it very well. And I want to warn people against that type of a scenario. Don't feel that the plants are the way to go simply because you're in a hurry to get there. Do not storm the gates of heaven using ayahuasca or psilocybin or marijuana or any of these light-bearing plants as a fast track to get into enlightenment without having to do a day of meditation, without having to do a day of forgiveness, without having to do a day of tolerance. Okay, kundalini deserves the work and the dedication that a person like Dukina is willing to put into the process. Just because you get there doesn't mean that you stay there. Once you get there, you have to earn your way there to stay. So, you know, many of the current teachers that actually have kundalini, which aren't that many, they will say, and I will echo it as well, it's easy comparatively. It's easy to awaken the kundalini or to activate it. It's very difficult to keep it there, to have it and to hold it. And that's what the safeties really are all about doing, is to keep it within the context of continuously refining the person's soul evolution to the point where they are enlightened. And as many of you know, my understanding of enlightenment as given to me by my kundalini is this, and I'll spell it for you. Enlightenment is I-N space L-I-G-H-T space I-N space M-E-A-N-T, enlightenment, which basically means you are meant to be enlightened. It is something that all humans are designed to have occur for them. Now, your society may not be ready for you to be enlightened, but you yourself, such as, you know, a person like Santara, Drakina, or Rosemary, or Fashji, or Brandon, you know, Brandon's, you know, doing quite well in the kundalini, and he's quite far along, and he's dealing with certain, you know, certain levels of enlightenment. So I want to say that because you take a plant helper and it pushes you into the availability of having kundalini, doesn't mean that you don't have to do any work. You still have to do your spiritual practice. In our case, we talk about the safeties. You still need to do the safeties every day, if not twice a day. A person in Drakina's position, where she's had the activated kundalini for 3 weeks, well, she's not into an awakening format yet. She's still within the activated format, which the activated format is basically initiating transformation of on a cellular level, on a physical cellular level. And so she's moving through the activation stage towards an awakening stage. And that awakening stage will be, you know, quite profound for her, as it is for most people. So getting back to the ayahuasca, in my experience with it, not only with ingesting it myself, but also having, going down to Peru and having an ayahuasca ceremony in three different places with two different shamans, it's pretty safe for the Kundalini. It's not going to hurt the Kundalini one bit. If you got a lot of heaving to do, get your diaphragm ready, because that's what controls the heaving is your diaphragm. So get that ready. Do the fasting if you're going to do it. No animal products, basically juice fast, no mango, as I can recall this, yeah. And then, of course, no alcohol, no drugs, no caffeine, no stimulants of those natures. Anything that would get in the way of the ayahuasca. But let's move it from ayahuasca. Syrian rue is another plant, and Syrian rue is sometimes used as an admixture with the ayahuasca. If you go to the Arrowid Vault, Arrowid Vault, VAULT, you'll see all the different entheogens. Entheogen is the word for light-bearing plant. You'll see all the different light-bearing plants that people like to experiment with. I won't recommend that you experiment with anything. I won't recommend it. Only if your Kundalini chooses for you to do this will I recommend it. And those are for those of you that are active right now, that are awakening in this process right now. You may not need to have ayahuasca. Okay, you're already in the process. Kundalini's working for you. It's changing you right now. Okay, but if you desire a level of clarity, a level of more information of a spiritual nature that perhaps your ego blockages at this point aren't allowing you to have, well then, yeah, have the ayahuasca experience. Have the marijuana experience. Have the LSD experience. Don't do the psilocybin thing. I will not at all recommend psilocybin. Not because I have a problem with magic mushrooms. I don't. I take them. Okay. They're great. They have a very, very pronounced effect. But if you're searching for God or anything of a Kundalini nature, which I wasn't when I took it, I was not in any way interested in that type of thing. Don't do it with the search for spiritual enlightenment, because it can really rock your, it comes on so strong that it can damage the sixth and the seventh chakras. And they'll heal. Don't get me wrong. Chakras aren't like, once you damage them, they're not forever damaged. But for sometimes it takes a really, really long time for this healing to take place. And in the meantime, you're being virtually driven crazy with psychic phenomena that you don't agree with, that you never wanted to have, that, it can be very, very damaging to a person's life. Within the professional context, if you've taken psilocybin will crush blue. Okay, I try to keep people away from the plants, but especially the mushrooms. There's only one form of Amanita that is safe, and that's Amanita muscaria, or otherwise known as fly agaric. There is no known deaths occurring with that particular Amanita. Every other Amanita will kill you. Every other Amanita will kill you. Amanita pantera and all of the different, death's angel, all the different Amanitas, they will kill you. They will actually kill you. There's only two types that won't kill you, and they're basically the same thing, but they're a different color. Amanita muscaria is the red mushroom with the white spots that you see with all the elves in the Christmas pictures. You'll see these little red and white spotted mushrooms, and and they have a lot to do with enlightenment of pineal gland and things of that nature. So Amanita muscaria comes in red with white dots and gold with white dots, and you can't miss it. They're fairly big. They grow in a symbiotic relationship with pine needles. So pine trees and Amanita muscaria go hand in hand, which also tends to have a projected point of understanding that the pineal gland and the Amanita also have a relationship. Now, if you take any book, or if you go online, or if you talk to any experienced mushroom gatherer, they'll always say, stay away from the Amanita muscaria. It's deadly. It'll kill you. But I'm saying that no, that one is not deadly. All the other ones are. So you have to be very, very, very careful when you're dealing with these mushrooms, because most of them are dangerous to you. Well, you know, most of them within the Amanita family are deadly, deadly, deadly. That one, Amanita muscaria, Flaria agaric, cannot. And they've never known. I mean, I suppose if you ate a ton of them or so, I mean, you probably have some problems. But we're not talking about that so much. There are many things. Let's just go with marijuana in a Kundalini context. Marijuana is not going to hurt the Kundalini, but what it does is it develops a physical addiction, not a physical addiction, but a psychological, emotional addiction with regards to the person's behavior patterns. People who smoke a lot of marijuana have a pronounced lack of control over their emotional expression. So in some way, the THC, the tetrahydrocannabinol, if it's used to a point of abuse, then it will begin to eat away at the person's emotional control. And I don't want you to experience that. Other than that, our brain is set up to receive THC. We have receptor cells in our brain that are there just for THC reception and bonding. And so throughout the evolution of the species, hunter gathering, we during those hunting and gathering years, we depended quite a bit on the marijuana plant and the different species of hemp, and we developed in our brain because of that interaction, we developed those receptor sites. So we have that in our chemistry already. The Kundalini isn't damaged by it, but it's sometimes helped, because a person who is using the THC can sometimes reach into exalted states of love, a great level of love or bliss, to the point where they're crying in bliss. And this can also happen with the THC. I will not recommend magic mushrooms or psilocybin. I don't have a problem with the peyote or any of those types of plants. The Saint Peter, I think that's what it's called, the cactus that they grow in Peru as well. And I absolutely have no problem with ayahuasca. LSD, yeah, bit of a problem with that because of its artificial construction. I can't say anything conducive towards the use of that kind of pharmaceutical fabrication. So I won't recommend it. But I know those who have had it, who have done it, some of them have been pushed into very, very strong levels of Kundalini, and I think that's great, and I support that, but I don't necessarily support it as a light-bearing plant, so to speak. So let's continue through this. A methamphetamine has absolutely no use in a Kundalini context. Absolutely none. It's just basically it's a toxin. that people are using because something is missing in their lives, and they you know, they're using that as a way to replace whatever it is that's missing in their lives. So cocaine, same thing. Cocaine differentiated from the coca leaf. If you go down to Peru and say you want to go up to Cuzco, which is 10,000 feet in the Andes, you'll want to chew the coca leaf. It's the only way that flatlanders who are not used to 10,000 feet altitude can enjoy themselves in Cuzco. Otherwise, you know, you'll find it hard to get out of bed, and your whole day is ruined because your body isn't used to the levels of oxygen there. When you chew the coca leaf, which is not like doing cocaine, you actually chew the leaf and you just kind of keep it in your mouth, and the nutrients keep coming into you. This resolves the altitude sickness that can occur in Cuzco, and all the hotels will have it in bowls out there. You know, here, chew the leaf, do this, do that. So just so you know about that. And if you are interested in using any of the shamans that I mentioned in this conversation, then just give me a private email at kfireforall@yahoo.com, and I'll do my best to answer your questions with regards to that. Also, I just wanted to say quickly, Drakina mentioned the videos, and the videos are on YouTube. There's 265 videos strictly on the Kundalini. And I will invite you to watch them. The YouTube ID is chrism.kundalini. And as you've ever gone onto YouTube, once you get, you know, that down, you'll see all the other all the videos that are being shown there. Also, you can go to Kundalini Awakening Systems, numeral1.com. So Kundalini Awakening Systems 1.com, and you can receive the information in a reading format there. And then, of course, you know, here at Blog Talk, you can listen to all these others. I've done Santara. Maybe you can count them up. But we've done quite a few of these conversations. Not all of them are 2 hours, but many of them are 2 hours. And I suggest that you really begin to enlighten yourself. And here's the thing that I was saying with Drakina was, if the Kundalini has led you to a certain level of information in a certain system, and this includes the light-bearing plants, then stick with it. But look at the entire picture. So, for instance, if the Kundalini is leading you to ayahuasca, and the only way you can get ayahuasca or to cook it up, because it takes a very special recipe to cook it up, you know, and it's in Peru, so you fly down to Peru, you have your 3 ayahuasca experiences, you fly back. You should not have any more contact in your homeland with the ayahuasca. Now, if you decide to stay in Peru for a while, well, that's fine. You know, and then, of course, you know, you can do the ayahuasca. But when you fly home, you have to remember that the Kundalini knows where you live. It knows what your geography is. It knows what's available to you from the society that you live in. It knows you. And so if it gives you the desire to go down to Peru and take the ayahuasca and then come back, well, that when you come back, you're not to take it anymore. Okay? Look at the entire picture of what the Kundalini would know about you. It knows what kind of car you drive. It knows what color your underwear are. I mean, you know, there's not too much about you that it doesn't know. There's nothing about you that it doesn't know. And so you need to take the instruction that it gives you in a serious fashion. So if you're if you're given the ability to fly down and to do the ayahuasca experience and then fly back up to Pennsylvania or wherever, then do that. But don't, once you're up in Pennsylvania, you don't want to keep trying to do the ayahuasca. Okay, you're doing it, you know, the 3 times was enough for you. One of the problems I have with students doing the ayahuasca is that they begin to depend on the ayahuasca for spiritual phenomena. Big mistake, because then you become so overly interested in spiritual phenomena that you you see the ayahuasca as the key that unlocks the door to your spiritual enlightenment. And it is not that key. It is a teacher that will help you bring yourself there. But it is not a teacher that is to be abused for recreational purposes or for, shall we say, an overactive level of desire to be a psychonaut or a person who likes to do all different kinds of psychotropic and psychedelic drugs. Okay. So just so you know that. Some of the other compounds, I wouldn't do any of the white powders, none of them, absolutely none of them. One of them, I wonder if I should even mention this. Well, okay. One's called Devil's Claw, and I will steer you away from that in the strongest suggestive words. It's also called Datura. It's also called Jimson Weed. Now, you can, you know, the human physiology can do that, but what you don't know is what the amount is appropriate for you. Many people die because they don't know what the amount is, and they're given this drug, and it just kills them, flat out kills them. Another person will have complete memory erasure. So all your memories will be erased, and you'll have to learn how to talk again. You'll have to learn how to write again. You'll have to learn how to communicate all over again as if you were a two-year-old. I have seen this occur. And I'm not allowed, you know, there's some things that you're not allowed to heal because the person needs to learn that way. And you know, I've seen like a high school kid try to smoke Jimson weed, and then he just has his memory is wiped. He has to be reintroduced to his family. He has to be reintroduced to communication through words, through sounds, through vocalizations, through reading, writing. I mean, it just sets a person back, and it can destroy a life. So be very careful with Jimson weed or Devil's Claw or that specific brand of plant. Not all of it is negative, but typically the way it's being used in our global society at this point, it is of a negative nature. I would like to encourage people to call in, 347-934-0026. Trying to think of some of the other drugs that are coming up. Maybe some of the folks in the chat room can suggest some of the drugs that they may have tried. Anybody in there willing to write something up there? Brandon, Celestial Rubies, Ravenice, Kundalini Fire, Fasci. Maybe some of you have had some psychonautical experiences in the light-bearing plant realm. There are various ways that a person can take some of the light-bearing plants, certainly within the Amazon basin. If you've looked at a movie called The Green or The Emerald Forest, The Emerald Forest is a story about a white child that's abducted by a tribe of indigenous people of the Amazon Valley and how they raise him and what they do. And one of the things that they do with him is to take him into the altered state by use of inhaling a mixture of light-bearing plants through the nasal mucosae. So they, you know, he, it's blown into his nose and his sinus passages, and he becomes able to bilocate. Okay, it looks like we have some. I see. Okay. So, yeah, let's see. Kundalini fire, yes. All right. For the most part, with regards to Kundalini, my Kundalini did not activate by use of plant helpers. Okay. My Kundalini activated, first of all, because it was destined to activate. Hi, Santara.
Hi, I'm putting Fasci on. He has a question for you, Chrism.
Thank you. Okay, hello, Fasci.
Master, how are you?
Good, good. Thank you for calling in.
Yes, I wanted to, it's not really a question just want to make sure I turn this thing down here.
Thank you.
My experience happened or precipitated through the use of mescalito or peyote, and it was very similar. I fasted and then chewed up several of the buttons, but the experience was a bit different from ayahuasca, which a number of months ago I decided that I wanted to purchase them, and there they sit, the ingredients, because the Kundalini, Shakti, advised me that I really didn't need that. It would short circuit the process at this point. So I wanted to say it's so important that we learn to communicate with the Kundalini in us, because it will indeed tell us exactly what we need for the next step. As a matter of fact, I made a post there that said that the awakening process is best in small amounts so that we can indeed digest fully what is being given. And I stand on that because that has been what I have found to be true. I don't, as you have said, suggest that this is something that we become reliant on. Once the teacher introduces you to the Kundalini, it's all about the work involved. You got to walk the walk. And I also want to interject that how important it is that we develop this one-on-one relationship and friendship with the Kundalini, because it will indeed make the gesture of friendship through intuition, through certain gifts energetically. But I just wanted to say how much I have enjoyed this particular satsang, because it is so informative of the things that people usually use to try to arrive at enlightenment, because I think it's inherent in all of us to want to reach that point of knowingness that is a part of our very substance. I guess I'm going to shut up because I just looked at the time. You've only got a few more minutes left. I wanted to say that mine came through Mescalito, and it was a great teacher. I started I saw the eyes on the walls, the blue eyes, but cool. What I noticed significant about this is that I started to see, I took it with a couple of other friends, and I started to see the different changes in their facial structure as it would happen throughout time, as time took its toll on them, the different features and how they changed and altered through time. And I remember looking into the sky and seeing the sky, and it took on a blue hue. So obviously, I guess Lord Shiva was helping along at that point. And I saw more, I'm certain I saw more shooting stars than were there at that time for the casual person looking in the sky.
Sure.
But these things all have a tremendous toll on the nervous system in the body. And that is one of the reasons and one of the insights that the Kundalini revealed to me, and that it's very important that once you are definitely on the path and doing the work, it's no longer necessary. find the teacher, and we have a teacher, and follow his instructions, and it should develop in its own time. Don't be in a rush. Just accept what is given and digest it. And I guess that's all I really have to say, Master. I just wanted to throw that in.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Fasji, for throwing that in.
You're quite welcome. I'll get off.
Yeah. Oh, okay, I'll do that there. There we are. Okay, yeah, he's absolutely correct. Absolutely correct. If you don't need to do this, you're going to hear animals in the background. I apologize. If you don't need to do this, don't do it. Like, for instance, me, my Kundalini didn't come up with any kind of a plant helper assistance. Not to say that I was against it. It's just that, you know, I couldn't afford it. If I could have afforded it at the time, I'm sure I would have tried it. But because I couldn't afford it, I didn't try it. And I think that was part of the plan as well. So you know, you can do this, you know, like mescalito or ayahuasca or La Purga. I mean, whatever the name is you want to use for it, even the Amanitas, you know, you can try all of those. The Amanita muscaria, not, you know, I should just say, I shouldn't even mention the Amanitas, I think. All Amanitas are deadly except one. And if you don't know what that one is, then don't even go near it. Let's just be straight up right now. Do not go near the Amanitas unless you know exactly what you're doing. Because you die. It's called liver failure. And you die, okay? So, the plant helpers, they're very good at giving you access to altered states that allow you to understand that you're more than a flesh being, okay? That's great. And that kind of knowledge can also come to you through the out-of-body experience as well. You know, you are not, you're just your physical body. You have an entire energetic anatomy as well, okay? So use the entheogens or the plant helpers. Fine. Don't get addicted to them. They are not to be abused, because then they'll start abusing you. You have to realize that when you get into these dimensions of interactivity, it's a two-way street. It's not a one-way street anymore. You know, when we're in our five-sense zone here, like we are right now, the five-sense zone meaning that, it's pretty much on your own terms, and, you know, A plus B equals C, and, you know, if you choose to do this or you that, well, that's fine, you know, but in the exalted states where you can walk a path, but a path also will walk you, or you can see an entity, but once you see an entity, they can see you. Or as you take an entheogen, well, the entheogen also takes you. Let's talk about another light-bearing plant. It's called Salvia divinorum. Now, Salvia divinorum is a plant that you can take, and it will give you divinations, which is where you get the name Salvia divinorum, right? It gives you divination, but Salvia divinorum is a plant that will do you. You'll all of a sudden become connected with all the salvias. Salvia is one of the largest plant species, flowering species in the world. It's a huge phylum. And Salvia divinorum, or Mexican sage, is another name for it, has the ability as an entheogen, and it will do you more than what you will do of it. So it can become a very, very, very strange and convoluted and somewhat scary type of a trip. Not for everyone, but for some. I won't recommend it for Kundalini. You know, as it doesn't have that type of a signature within it, and so I won't suggest the salvia, just as I won't suggest alcohol, just as I won't suggest nicotine, you know, just as I won't suggest, you know, copious amounts of nutmeg either. You know, I mean, all these different areas, levels and ways and pathways to do what we can do just naturally by going into meditation, for crying out loud. Maybe working towards astral projection so that you can go consciously without euphoria, go consciously in your straight mind into these areas and begin to learn, begin to extrapolate the information, begin to surrender yourself to your inner divine. Kundalini is all about surrendering themselves, surrendering, having the person surrender. While the activity is occurring. So if there is anybody with a question, we have 9 minutes left. That's the number is 347-934-0026. So I won't suggest salvia divinorum. I won't suggest alcohol, nicotine, or the Amanita muscaria, even though, you know, that one is okay. All the other ones are deadly. I won't suggest psilocybin, which is also referred to as magic mushrooms. The only one, there's actually the only two that I'm okay with is the ayahuasca, and that means that you're in a ceremony with it, and it's being handled by an experienced shaman, the dolphin shaman or the other shaman that I mentioned, and I can get a hold of them. Okay, they still email me and want me to bring people down. And so I've been considering another trip to Peru. So if there is interest out there in taking a trip to Peru, and I will chaperone people who are interested in the ayahuasca experience. And we can go ahead and get together with that. If you have an interest in that, why don't you contact Eileen Loro at eloro55@yahoo.com or Amelia Santara at kundalinimatters.com. And we'll see if something can be put together for that. In the meantime, if there are no more questions, and if people are pretty much, it looks like we have people typing here. DMT. So people do a lot of the artificial DMT. This is Drakina. She's talking about that again. I wouldn't necessarily suggest that any of these entheogens are a key to our divinity, but they're a window to it. They allow you to look and to experience some of it just through the actions of being involved in that entheogen's radiance. You know, as you feel the light-bearing plant release that light into you, well then, yeah, you'll begin to feel what it's like. But it, Kundalini is the doorway into divinity. So yeah, if the ayahuasca awakens your Kundalini, well then yes, it has become a doorway into the Kundalini for you, and so therefore you can extrapolate from that a doorway into divinity. For the most part, I will not recommend light-bearing plants as a vector into the Kundalini because it lacks discipline to a degree. I mean, the fasting, you know, that has discipline to it. If you're a shaman or you're inside of a shaman training, which is also a belief system training, well, then I think that you can partake of these light-bearing plants at a much safer environment than those who are just kind of experimenting, going to the arrowhead balls and, you know, looking at the different recipes and then choosing the recipe that they want to do. Those are typically recreational people that are doing this, and I am not talking about recreational usage at all. Okay, I'm talking about an educational experience that doesn't necessarily have to have bliss or euphoria involved, but more of an information experience. based involvement. And your dreams will communicate to you. For those of you who are Kundalini are active at this point, your dreams will tell you whether ayahuasca is appropriate to you, whether mescaline is appropriate to you, whether LSD or whatever it is appropriate to you. And typically it will not give that type of a permission for a person to do. The person's ego will most certainly do that. So you want to watch your ego, you know, within this context. Don't just think that, I want to do it, therefore I must need to do it. No, that's not true. To have a desire to do something does not necessitate a need to do it. And as Fasci mentioned, storming the gates of heaven is a good example of an ego deciding for itself that it wants to do this or that and to storm the gates of heaven. And, you know, there's some blowback from that type of an attitude. Looks like I have about 4 minutes left, and I want to go ahead and put the number out there again for anybody. 347-934-0026. Amelia, did you have some announcements you'd like to make? Could you say
hear
it again?
Me?
Now I can, yes. Go ahead.
Okay. I'd like to give out the details of contact again if people have an interest in coming to Dublin on October the 18th, 19th, and 20th for the Kundalini Awakening Seminar that you will be giving. So my email address is kundalinimatters@gmail.com, and I also have a phone number, which is 00353-86029-7676, and contact me if you would like some more information about that seminar. That's it, Chrism. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Santara. So, you might also inquire of Eileen Loro at ELORO55@yahoo.com, but Amelia Santara at kundalinimatters@gmail.com. With regards to the seminar, I would encourage everybody who can make it to the seminar to make it to the seminar. I have not found, I've looked hard for people that do what we do here, and I have not found it yet. I still search and I still hope, but nobody seems to be doing this, and I want all of you to take advantage of it. And I'm talking to you in the archives too. If you're listening to this at a later date, well, the information is still fresh and new for you. And so take this information, learn from it, apply it to your equation, your Kundalini equation, and don't depend on a drug or an entheogen or a plant helper or anything of an artificial or even an outside of your own inner divinity quality. Your Kundalini, through meditation, through prayer, through the practice of the safeties, through Shaktipat, can be activated in a way that will not blow your brains all over the ceiling. Some of these entheogens, some of these plant helpers, have the ability to blow your brains all over the ceiling. And so unless you need a new paint job on that ceiling, be very careful in how you take these entheogens. Always do your research. If you have an experienced person who's done it before, then definitely you know listen to them with if you trust them, and go for there. Do not, I except for ayahuasca, chacruna, those types of things, I wouldn't use it for the pursuing Kundalini because you don't like to meditate or pray or do a spiritual practice. It is not a lazy man's or lazy person's option in this way. I won't recommend it that way. Looks like I'm running out of time here. I get the person telling me I've got 60 seconds left. I want to thank everybody who's listening to this in the archives. I want to thank everybody Celestial Rubies, Brandon, Fasci, Kundalini Fire, which is also Drakina, and Ravenice, and the guest 239-227-17-2747-2823-3032 and 18380. Thank you all for listening, and I will see you, or we'll do this again next week, same station, same time. Thank you.